Welcome to the VEX Robotics Competition referee training videos designed for both referees and teams. This is Chapter 8, Trapping and Pinning. Pinning and trapping rules can often be sources of confusion for referees and teams. They can sometimes be more subjective than other rules, and it is difficult to categorize every possible type of robot-on-robot interaction. The examples and explanations given in this video should help teams and referees to develop a better idea of what trapping is and what it is not. Let's begin with the relevant definition. A robot is trapping if it has restricted an opposing robot into a small, confined area of the field, approximately the size of one foam field tile or less, and has not provided an avenue for escape. Trapping can be direct, such as pinning an opponent to a field perimeter wall, or indirect, such as preventing a robot from escaping from a corner of the field. In previous years, trapping and pinning were considered separate definitions. However, pinning is really just a specific form of trapping, so in the interest of simplifying rules, we combine them this season. Let's take a look at some examples. Direct trapping is what most people envision when they think of pinning. A robot holding another robot against a field element, such as a wall or platform, and preventing them from getting away. However, trapping can also be indirect. This robot is effectively restricted to a small area of the field, but without the aggressive contact associated with a traditional pin. A robot does not actually have to be contacting its opponent for trapping to occur, so long as the opponent cannot break out of the confined area and play the rest of their match. In all forms of trapping, there is a responsibility on the part of the robot being trapped to make a visible and active effort towards breaking free. Simply sitting in a corner without moving will not result in a violation. Now, let's take a look at Rule G14, which explains how pinning and trapping should be handled during a match. A robot may not trap an opposing robot for more than 5 seconds during the driver-controlled period. Once a referee has identified that trapping has begun, they should provide a clear verbal and visual cue to all teams that a pin count has begun. This means that you should use your hand to count, gesture to the violation if possible, and count loudly and clearly. When teams notice a referee counting down, they will usually back off sooner than the full 5 count, and the count will effectively end up acting as a warning to all teams. Also, it's important for referees to be assertive when calling for a trapping count. Referees are sometimes hesitant to start counting until after the trap has already been clearly established. This can turn a 5-second count into 8 or 9 seconds of actual trapping. This is one of the most common sources of frustration for teams and new referees. A direct trap, often referred to as a pin, should be easy to identify. Just watch for a robot not moving who is stuck between a field element and an opponent robot. An indirect trap may be more difficult to identify, but is still important to watch for. In VRC Turning Point, there usually isn't much reason for robots to sit in one place, especially if they aren't in the act of scoring. So, if you see a robot stuck in a corner, with an opponent strafing side to side in front of them, they are probably being trapped. If you're still not sure, a verbal warning is a good start. You could even just say something as simple as, "Let them out of there!" The next section of the rule states, a trap is officially over once the trapping robot has moved away and the robots are separated by at least 2 feet or approximately 1 foam field tile. After ending a trap, a robot may not trap the same robot again for a duration of 5 seconds. If a team does trap the same robot again, the count will resume from where it left off when the trapping robot initially backed off. There should be no confusion that the offending team has either not satisfied their 5 seconds or has not backed away far enough. This is a very commonly misunderstood part of the call. If you wait for the aggressor to back a full field tile away before even stopping the count, then there will be no confusion. Once you've stopped the count, take a mental note of the time on the field timer and keep an eye on the aggressor. Defensive teams will often ride the very edge of this limit. This is legal, but only if they wait the full 5 seconds and only if they move the full field tile away. Now, there are 2 subtle details regarding trapping that are worth mentioning. First, if an opposing robot blocks a team from moving away and breaking a pin, then the count can be ended. This is related to G11, which states that you cannot cause an opponent to violate a rule. In this case, it means that you cannot force a robot to trap another robot. And lastly, but perhaps most importantly, if your robot stops working for any reason, you are still responsible for its actions. This means that if you are in the act of trapping and you lose control of your robot, while your opponent is still unable to break free, then a trapping count or violation would still occur. That said, the opposite is also true. If your robot malfunctions while being trapped and you stop trying to escape, then the count will stop. This could mean a dead battery, an overheated motor, or a radio disconnect. In any case, your robot is no longer actively trying to break free. It would be silly to penalize someone for trapping a robot that can't move. Sometimes when a trapping count occurs, drivers will try and show the referee that they are not touching their controls. This is actually counter to the definition of trapping as explained in this video. If you're the one being trapped and you're not touching the controls, then you're essentially telling the referee to stop counting because you're no longer trying to break free. On the other hand, if you're the one doing the trapping, it doesn't matter whether you're touching your controls or not, because you are still responsible for the actions of your own robot. Trapping is one of the most difficult calls to make in the VEX Robotics competition, but it is necessary to ensure a fair and offensive game. As such, referees need to be vigilant and confident when watching for these violations. They must also clearly communicate when warning teams and counting out loud to deter potential violations. That's all for Chapter 8. But make sure you check out our other videos, which explore other refereeing topics.